Okay, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
Good evening, thank you. I'm Jeff Prudence, Chair of Simsy Facilities Management, and I'd like to welcome you all here tonight for the launch of KS21, which has been kindly hosted by Steve Cheshire and his team here at Brookfield. So thank you very much for that. There are no scheduled fire alarm tests, so if there is any alarms, we'll follow Steve and his team out through the designated exits. Also, this is a live round-the-clock building with trading across the world, so please respect, it's a live office outside, so when we're having our drinks and when we leave, just respect that and be quiet as we leave. Also, if you haven't already seen the warnings or been told by Steve, the models, please don't touch them or spill any crisps on them. And he told me the other day, if you particularly want to see this one, just look outside, because that's it going up, that one over there. But again, thank you so much for hosting this great event in these great surroundings. So welcome to the formal launch of KS21, the knowledge series document around competency and competency management. It's within the task group, which is chaired by Joe, and the two Steve's lead authors, which will be talking to you tonight. For me, it's around providing leadership around competence and instruction. Lots of talk about what's competence, what does it mean, how do you prove it. I'll let Joe and Steve explain the background of how they come to put this together, but a fantastic amount of work that I hope will be pushed out there and be a great standard that people promote debate and use. A bit more about Simsy and Simsy FM. Claire's here tonight. If you do want to purchase the guide, rather than £50, it's a special offer tonight, £25. If you want to join Simsy as an affiliate member and paid a hundred and something, whatever it is now, you can download this and all the other guides for free. And we're around from the Simsy FM group. If you want to join the Simsy FM group for free and come to our own events, that's fine too. So without further ado, I'll hand over to Joe Harris, lead author of the guide.
Thank you very much. Right, so for those that you haven't met me, I'm an engineer, a maintenance engineer, come up through the system through apprenticeships. I did work 14 years as a consultant at Bizria, but have now moved on and gone back client side, which is more entertaining. But this guide is obviously written by the committee. Steve and Steam are the driving forces behind it. I just push them along. It all came out of our work with Guide M, if you're familiar with that one, maintenance management. Management of maintenance engineering, something like that. And we had a legislation chapter in there that we thought was not adequate for the job for this. So let's have a look. Here we go, that's the title of the guide that I'd forgotten. What we realised while we were writing this is that legislation is pushing us to have competent persons. You know, everything by risk assessment these days, we are, you know, legislation is pushing that responsibility down the chain as far as they can. And just we felt we weren't adequately covering it in that guide. And one of the things that we also sort of realised was that just because you're trained doesn't necessarily mean you're competent. And that's one of the subjects we kind of wanted to address. So that comes up with this guide. It's taken us 18 months, so I'm not saying it's hot off the press, because it's taken us a while, but it's a subject area that hasn't changed in all that time. You know, it's becoming more topical further we get. I gather there was some conversations at a Simsy meeting yesterday about competency, and it's becoming more important that we know about it and what it is. So it's introducing you to the journey of competency and competency management. It's not going to tell you exactly what to do. We, as an industry, when the bubble burst, we got rid of apprenticeship schemes. Our engineers aren't coming from the army anymore. They're all going off. So, you know, our skilled engineers, our skilled staff, we're struggling. And if you throw in Brexit and everybody goes home, you know, where are our engineers coming from? How are we going to make sure that we have a competent workforce? We have multi-skilled people with diluted their knowledge, if you like, because people's brains are only big enough to do so much. They cannot be jack of all trades and still be competent in multiple subject areas. So we've got to look about how we are managing our multidisciplinary teams. And with the legislation, pushing that competency down to the lowest level. And actually, don't forget that the managers need to be competent at what they're doing too. There's a lot of managers coming into FM from diverse backgrounds. So in an engineering room full of engineers, I will say, we have people running buildings who don't understand engineering systems. And we need to ensure that they are competent to understand what they need to comply with and how their teams are providing that confidence, competency. Why did we write it? Well, mostly it's because Steve said he could. But it's more about raising the awareness, getting the conversation started. We want you to understand that this is an important part of FM. FM is a people business. 85% of FM's costs are about the people costs. We have staff. That's what we're selling to our customers, and they need to be competent to do that job so that we protect ourselves and our businesses when we sell competent staff. And we just really want to push you in the right direction. Protect yourselves and provide that source of information, because there's lots of information about competency, lots of definitions that we found while we were researching the guide, but there's not one place you can go in FM that says this is what competency means in this industry. It's about making sure you don't fall down the gaps, protecting yourselves, identifying gaps. You've got a lot of work to do to inwardly look. If you're thinking that somebody's going to come and have a look at you, well, actually, you should have looked yourself first. We're all audited to death, and this is another area we should all be looking at. So that's me. I'm going to say good luck, because if you haven't started down this route, it's a journey. It's not a one-stop shop. You're not going to do it tomorrow. It's a journey you need to embark on, and you need to take other parties with you. I'll let Steve explain that to you. So, first up is Steve Gathergood. He's going to cover the competency side.
So, good evening, everyone. Okay. Right. So, yes, I'm going to follow on really with a little bit of background about competency per se, what that is, how it's defined. And build on a little bit around what we need to think about in terms of our people and how we manage and develop them. Okay. No, too far. There we go. Okay, so I'm not going to read all the words verbatim. What I will say is that what this guide tries to do is explore and focus and offer a focused insight into the need for competency and really focus on why it's particularly important on high risk and safety systems. That doesn't detract from the fact that competence is important all the way down the supply chain, right to the plumber, the painter, the decorator. It's important that also it's not just inferred due to a safe working practice. It's demanded by our UK judicial and legal system. There are lots and lots of directives, regulations, acts that make reference to the need for competent, skilled, approved, various phraseology around particular persons. It tells you what you need, it doesn't tell you what it is. It also doesn't tell you how to get it. So, as Joe said, what this guide tries to do is give you a bit of a helping hand as to how to protect yourself, both from that statutory and mandatory risk. It's also not unreasonable to accept that in the event of an incident or an accident on one of your sites, you need to be able to demonstrate the competency of that individual or individuals that was involved in that. The result, of course, as you're probably all well aware, is fairly punitive measures, and that can be financial, it can be custodial, it could be both. So it's really, really important. what the document also does is it looks to explain the risk, the proportionality and the liability associated with specific competent roles, and we'll come on to that a bit later. It also looks at how, if you get it right and you manage from the bottom up, the effective management of the individual can actually move more to the organisation being competent and create a corporate competency, which I think Steve will allude to in the second part of this, around how that helps organisations with a unique selling point in terms of how to market themselves out in terms of more work, bid winning, etc. Also, there's a really important linkage with human resources. If, like me, you don't think HR necessarily does the job that you think HR should do these days, which is about managing our expensive resource, which is people, and are more about looking at guiding people like me that are in ops roles to say what I need to do about my people, then this really tries to crystallise the fact that HR have got a massive part to play in terms of ensuring that we protect that financial investment of people. And lastly, it's about managing, controlling, developing, maintaining that competent knowledge, making sure that what we've got locked away in our staff is actually exploited, properly utilised, and that we get the benefits from that. So that's broadly what the document tries to do, and I know that's quite far-reaching, and we haven't given you a definitive answer in this because it's practically impossible, but hopefully there's enough in there that will guide you down the route. Right, okay. So before I go any further, I wanted just to sort of discuss a subtlety, really, and that is competencies versus competent. They're different. So most organisations, again, coming back to our friends in human resources, and you've probably all seen these as part of your development reviews, managerial competencies, administrative competencies. Generally speaking, somebody thrusts a table in front of you which has got a number of statements, and you as a manager are expected to try and sort of box your individual to where they best fit in terms of a competency. Having those competencies doesn't mean that they're competent to do the role that you've employed them for. There's a much wider piece there in terms of, well, what is their job description? What is their role? Which ones of those competencies do they need and at what level to give an inferred level of competence? So they are subtle, so don't fall into the trap of thinking that just because you've gone through a technical review and you've benchmarked an individual that you've done enough. You probably haven't, particularly if you come back to an accident or an incident like I mentioned earlier. So what I think we're saying there is, within FM and technical FM in particular, we should be looking at those competencies slightly differently. We should be considering competencies as behaviours that excellent performers exhibit much more consistently than average performers. And to be competent, we should consider the attainment of the relevant grouping of behaviours or those competencies that, when taken together, better describe and communicate that individual's performance expectations. I've read that because those are the words we've used in the document. Do you understand what I'm trying to say by that? People nodding, that's good. Okay, so that's important when we move on to competence now generally. So, what is it? So as Joe alluded to, there are numerous definitions of what is competence. They are in numerous documents. Various organisations have made up their own definitions to suit their own slight sector-specific area. But generally speaking, the bullet points that are at the top there, which I will read in this instance, have really been the cut and thrust of what we think are the key aspects of competency. The ability of a person to carry out a task to an effective standard. relatively simple but quite far-reaching. The combination of training, skills, experience, knowledge, and their ability to apply them to perform that task safely. And then, of course, other factors. Does the guy want to do the job? Has he got the right physical ability and the right attitude to do it? If you've got disillusioned staff, they may actually not be as competent as you think they are because they don't want to do the job and therefore are more likely to take risks, putting your organisation at risk. And also the combination then of practical and thinking skills, experience and knowledge that may include a willingness to undertake the work activities. Those are taken from health and safety guidance, those are taken from regulation, those are taken from various interpretations in terms of good codes of practice and the like. But we feel that they are, in essence, a good representation of competence. So, accepting all of that, as I alluded to why it's important, so we have this UK legislative framework which we work in, and there's a little triangle there, which I guess you've all probably seen before. Highest level of precedent in terms of primary legislation, in terms of the Act or the regulation, followed by the approved codes of practice and then other guidance. So the fact that these are all referenced, we need to comply, and that definition of how to achieve or what ingredients, if you like, of competence will help us do that. So hopefully that puts the legal importance into perspective. Okay, I mentioned appointments. So within the FM sector, competency roles are often quoted in job descriptions, but not often with any definition around what that means. So what people seem to have adopted generally is to align and utilise common titles which you find in the MOD framework and in healthcare environments. So the blue bubble that you can see there, you've probably all got them or heard of them, authorising engineers, competent persons, approved persons. These are all titles. They are bestowed upon individuals based on a level of competency following an assessment, or should be. The fact that you're employed to be a designated person, for example, doesn't mean you're competent to do it necessarily, unless it's properly defined in your business process and it's fully articulated as to what those behaviours, those competencies you need collectively to give you a level of competence. The appointment to those roles, importantly, is not a competency in its own right. So don't be fooled into thinking just because you've got somebody in your supply chain that is pushing themselves off as an appointed person or an authorising engineer, that doesn't infer, well, it does tell a lie, it infers they have a level of competency, but it's not a, it's not indicative that they have the competency in its own right. In order to prove that, there need to be auditable and demonstrable records. And again, there's an importance then for their supervising manager or whomever that might be to undertake regular reviews of that person's capability and ongoing competence and suitability for that role. Appointment to those roles, however, do assert an increased level of competence by inference. And what that means is that they must have defined responsibilities and boundaries. What it also means is that that individual should be able to be more readily relied upon for expert advice. So the two scenarios there are, is if you ask somebody who has a particular role, an appointment, for example, of authorising engineer, and you just have somebody who is a competent person, and you ask both for advice, even if the advice was wrong, in a court of law, you would lean towards the authorising engineer's advice as being more valid due to the inference of competency of position. Does that make sense? Thank you. Okay. So, moving on. risk and proportionality. So, coming back to our judicial system, it's based on a framework of compensation. So, what that means is that if you do something naughty, the judge hands down a sentence which is appropriate and proportionate to the wrong that you have done. Competency is just the same. So the level of competency that an individual should possess must be both appropriate and proportionate to the risks associated with the job or the task that they are doing. That's really simple, isn't it? It sounds really simple. So on that basis, what we're saying is the level of competency for somebody that is painting a wall is a lot less than the level of competency for somebody that is switching high voltage electricity. It's really, really obvious. But it doesn't always follow in facilities management because people, unfortunately, don't understand how to properly risk assess the jobs and to properly assess the competence of the individuals that they are asking to do those tasks. So a good rule of thumb that you might want to remember is that in all cases, the level of competence should be proportionate to the task and its associated risks. Write it down, put it on your desk, think about it. It's so obvious and it will keep you out of trouble. So hierarchy. A director of the board must embrace the principles of risk and proportionality to determine the competency levels of their business activities. So what does that mean? That means that ultimately the man or the lady at the top is responsible for determining the business process within which they work, how their staff and their resources are going to be assessed, developed, trained and managed so that they are able to deliver the job that they are required to deliver without placing any risk or any unsafe practice on either the individual or the organisation. And importantly, the onus of proof of competence will always fall upon the employing organisation. So if you get it wrong and you can't prove it, then you have a problem. So records and general management and maintenance of competence is hugely important. And I can guarantee now, looking around this room, probably there aren't many people that have got records that go back maybe 3 to 5 years that demonstrate that they have done competency assessments on their people. Unless you want to tell me different. So this is the this is the competence continuum. So what this tries to show is this tries to graphically represent and help you understand how the level of competence relates to the level of supervision that would need to be applied to a particular operative undertaking a particular task. So what we're basically saying here is we're saying that it's not simple, it's not linear. Competence can be impacted by a number of external factors. So once you've done it, doesn't mean that's it. You've got to continually go back and reassess. But by doing regular reviews and looking at the sensitivities will better allow you to put in corrective actions that may be necessary. So what we're saying, if we look at the red where it says maximum supervision, what we're saying there is we have an operative that may be an apprentice, for example, that's relatively new in the job, undertaking a role that maybe he's not particularly experienced with, he hasn't done it very often before. So what we do is we put a level of supervision over that individual to ensure that actually he's mentored and that he's doing the job properly and safely. As that apprentice then moves through his working life and he's still doing the same job, he moves to the right because actually he's got familiarity now. He's had the training, he's got more confidence around the work that he's doing, his general attitude to doing his work has improved. So if we go back to the definitions, all of those things come into play. And as his competency moves to the right, his line manager can take a step back and say, I don't now need to supervise him quite as much because he's improved. And then we have utopia on the far hand, right-hand side where it's minimum supervision because the individual is doing the task day in, day out. He's trained, he's capable, he's enthused, he's motivated, he's willing. He is a competent person.
But lo and behold, what happens? Technology changes. There's a change in the environment. There's a new technology, as I say. There's some additional training that's brought in by a learned body. These external factors now constitute a change. So what does that mean? Well, all of a sudden, this guy's now not quite as competent as he thought he was because something's changed. So he slides back a little bit to the left. Now, supervision in this case isn't now going to help, but we'd have to put in a corrective action, which might be retraining. It might be re-education on whatever that new technology is or what that delivery method might be. So this is a dynamic, or it was intended to try and represent a dynamic view of how competency can change over time, acknowledging these external factors. And an FM is a massively diverse subject area. We all deal with multiple work streams. So it's been impossible really to sort of condense this into something more absolute. But the principle is there are things acting on competence that you need as managers and supervisors, you need to be aware of to enable you to put in place those corrective actions that will help you protect yourself and your company. Word of caution, some organisations we've seen try to grade competence using, shall we say, non-defined descriptors, like this man's knowledgeable, this lady's proficient, this person's advanced. There are other examples like trainee, supervised practitioner, expert. Well, you know, they're all rubbish, really, because they're undefined. There's no common benchmark for what those terms mean. And therefore, if you transfer between organisations and you take those with you, they may mean something completely different. Again, exposing you and putting you at risk. So, because they're not universally defined, our view would be steer clear of putting badges on levels. Use the development process and what Steve's going to talk about, into the management system that you have in place within your organisation, which is bespoke to you. And with that, I'll now hand over to Steve, who'll expand on how you can manage it. Thank you.
Thanks, Stephen. Right. While I get started, thanks everybody for coming. I understand there is a real strike on today, and the efforts that you must have made to come in was fantastic. It shows also the importance of competency management to you all. And it's either that or the sandwiches that Stephen's got on later must be really fantastic. So I'm going to start off and take on from what Joanne and Stephen have said, and I'm going to talk about competency management. When you've identified your competent staff and you're moving them through your business. So I'm going to start with, get the mouse right, what we discussed as we were going through. The Engineering Council's got an excellent model for taking forward the identification and the understanding of competence. Quite a lot of people within the room have been through it. It looks at your knowledge, it assesses your knowledge, you get a peer review, you get to put a paper in, you get to submit documents and explain it. It's the same principle that we're saying that you need to do with the commencement of your management system. You need to take the effort and dedication, and you need to commit to providing a satisfactory competence level. The approach to the type of competency is via a formal and an informal learning. Identifying that they've got relevant competencies, qualifications and certificates, if appropriate. Some jobs don't need them. Some jobs you might think by the task and you've done your proportionality review, we don't need that level of competency. I don't need a chief engineer to do this. I don't need a painter to do it. I'll employ a carpenter. So you can do that and you can work it through just on what levels you need. You need to understand the training levels and that they're up to date for the people that you're looking for to match the competencies that you're defining. The experience gained needs to be relevant to the task that they're doing. And Engineering Council do put that in to some levels of proportion when you go through and you look. There's a need for a formal appointment. Stephen emphasised it as he was going through. Define scope. Give them limitations. You can only work in this building. You can only work in my portfolio. You're only competent to work in the UK. You need to give them limitations when you put them through. Don't let them think they can go and work on every system anywhere. They'll be overly confident, very sure of themselves, and you need to set the scope as to what they're doing. And again, it's within the definition of the risk and proportionality. There are certification bodies out there, and they do give organisations certificates. It doesn't mean that the individual people working within that organisation are competent. It means the organisation that they've been have passed a series of audits and inspections that they've gone through. Not necessarily that people are competent. Organisational competency. Oh, I've just done that one, so I'm all right. I'll move on. Competence management. It's the arrangement to control and logically integrate in a manner the cycle of activities within the organisation that will develop and perform competent people. The aim of it, as it's set through, is to ensure that the individuals are clear and have understanding about what they have to perform, what's expected of them, how they can receive appropriate training, and it's taking it on to receiving development training, development assessments, and how they maintain the competency that they're at. It's relevant, their competency, that is relevant to the task at the time that they're employed and that they're working on your systems. Benefits of the CMS. We've got to have something that makes it valuable. It has to have something that makes it really worthwhile to do it. And there are so many benefits that you can get through. We've listed a few. I think it's 3/4 of the page that we've got when we went through in there. The CMS system embedded within your organisation is a strategic differentiator when you go out within the industry, whether you're a client, corporate, or whether you're a service provider. It is really important. For service provider, it's a good, unique selling point. You can sit down in front of a client quite confident and turn around and say, we've got good people, we manage, we've got a structure, and here's the evidence we can prove it. Within an organisation, competency can be linked to a common platform based on an IT solution with defined standards. Okay, so just expand on that a little bit further. It needs to be a simple system. Doesn't have to be complex. It can be. It really looks to be embedded within a HR process and a HR system. So it follows an employee through the recruitment process, through their employment process, through their induction, through to where they are comfortable within your organisation. And you think, he's a good guy. I've checked. He's all in place. He ticks all my boxes. He's at the far end of Stephen's continuum. I can rely on it, he's there. Business changes, organisation changes, the environment changes. We need to relook at how we manage competency. And the guide, the knowledge series, helps explain that. Part of the CMS process is it helps with your 31,000 risk review, your 9,001 processes, and it helps with your 14,001 processes. Once you've got that management system in place, it keys into lots of other ISO accreditations that you need to use for verifying putting it through. So your CMMS, it can be standalone, it can be an Excel spreadsheet, it can be a highly complicated training and development process which your HR or your organisation can. It needs to effectively support an understanding of gap analysis, and it needs to fit in with succession planning. I'm heading down the route, and the document's heading down the route. It's very much a partnership with how you want it to run within your organisation and your HR department and your training department if you've got it, or the single person who does it all within your team. But you need to establish and identify work activities associated with the risks and the relevant standards that they need to satisfy. You need to build into your CMS within the organisation, ensure job descriptions match the profiles of the tasks that people are expected to do, and the criteria of the job is proportional to the duties. The HR process is integrated and embedded within the organisation's culture. The implementation that we go through. Selection and recruitment of your staff. Once you've done all of the work, the press has gone out, and you're interviewing, it's all of that process that you need to go through to make sure that you get the right person. And that's against the criteria that you set up against the risks that are in your business, not necessarily the hierarchy structure you need to fill for your gaps. You need to maintain and monitor the competency and performance, which is an ongoing review that needs to be done. Because people change, businesses change, companies go through states of re-engineering. Verify, audit and review are one of the key areas that we go through. And it comes out again in the slide further on. Here's an example on the screen which I've pulled through from the document. Within KS21, we use two competency processes. First one, which is on the left, is associated with COMA, control and management of major accident hazards, which is a 2012 document. And there's a health and safety document, which is a straightforward flow diagram, which is the one that's on the right. They both follow the same principles. We use, within the document, the COMA process for managing competency. We see it as being more relevant. We see it as being more suitable to the wider businesses that we are. It's an industry. And the one on the right, which is health and safety one, is a 2001 document. It's ideal, but it's a little bit narrower with regards to the process. And we've got that section in Appendix 1 with its explanation as to how it works and how to use it. So each of these incorporate the need for preparation, learning and improvement, and they're put through and they're explained in more detail in the document. Phase 5 of that COMA review that we went through is all about the review and the audit, and it's all about verifying that you've got a system in place, and it's got a big explanation put through this in page 12 of the document. It's an important phase of the CMMS. It's where you learn and improve, make changes, identify gaps, identify that your business has changed or you've just taken on board a new client with a new system and a new process, and you need to upskill or change the stuff that you've got either within your business or on site. So it's an important bit. Organisations, business and management structures need to regularly meet the contractual and customer needs to ensure the roles and the profiles match those changes that have happened within your business. Skills testing is often performed. There's various manager skills testing, and again, it's down to proportionality. There's such tests as HV switching, HV electrical testing, pressure systems, and these can be scenario-based or task-based. There's process we use within the organisation I'm with at the moment, and we have integrated systems testing, which means that we work within buildings, and the engineers learn how the building functions and operates in various shutdown scenarios so they can act and react. And it's not just their core skill, they'll be working on a cooling system with the heating engineers and the electricians, or have people in support as mechanics. KS21 has got documents within it. Apologies for that.
Case 21 within the appendix has got some documents that we've put through, which are model templates, so they can be used to review, cross-reference against what you've currently got in your business, or plagiarise and develop and use where you might not have them. But they're examples, they're things that we've pulled through from organisations. Some useful help. This is quite familiar, I think everybody in the room is probably familiar with this. Plan, Do, Check, Act. It's got a section at the very end of the document. It's one of the last parts because it sits there important, telling you to reflect. Asking you if you've done all the planning, asking you if you've done all the checking. Making sure you've got to act and learn from what you've developed. Using the structure that we've come through, the framework, it can be used to motivate your employees because they understand you've got something in place, a structure, and that you're prepared to learn and invest in their competencies. The benchmarking can help. It's part of the retention of staff. It's understanding what levels of person you're looking for to match the tasks and the risks that you've got associated with your work. Costs and benefits to the business. It's key, we're all commercial. Better use of your resources, better knowledge that you've got within your staff will create much greater retention, less staff turnover, less need for training and development, and reliability with your engineers and team on site. Work within the organisation as well, which is in all this needs to be, as Steve pointed out, verifiable and auditable. So that's the basic principles of the CMMS system that we've gone through. I'd like to pass you back to Joe, who can do go through some of the summaries. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you.
My water.
Okay, so we've bamboozled you enough. So in summary, it's about managing risks within your organisation, proportional to your tasks that you're asking people to do. Making sure that the right people are doing the right, are fulfilling the right roles for your organisation and for your customers. We're strong believers that HR need to pick this up and embed it in their processes. It's probably gone too far the other way about keeping people happy. You know, they need to come back and think about how they're going to support the organisation, manage their competencies. One of the things that Steve slipped over on one of his slides was about records, documenting and maintaining that. You know, we mentioned 3 to 5 years. If you are going to have a system in place where you can rely on it to demonstrate competence, then you've got to maintain those records. We can motivate people. We are a people business, so we need to be thinking about performance reviews. Too many people, too many engineers bounce from contract to contract because they don't feel valued in their organisation. This is one way you can show value. You can show them how they can climb the competence ladder, if you like, and how you can monitor their tasks that they're doing. Competence which is authorised by the organisation. So your organisation knows what engineers are doing, what tasks they're performing, and is comfortable and can protect themselves. And that last one, auditable. There's no point putting in a system that only you know how to use. You need to be able to demonstrate it to other people. So thank you very much for coming. Thanks for listening. We've left some takeaway points up there for you, some things to start your journey, your job specifications, get them clear, make them understandable, show the limitations of each role, use them when you're recruiting, interviewing. Don't just let the HR drive that process. Make sure you get the right engineers for the right jobs. And continue. Don't stop after 3 months when they've got their probation done. Keep going, check the competencies, keep developing our engineers. actually, if you need it, there's
something.
It's part
of the process. The disciplinary capability
is
part of the process.
It's, it comes back to, you know, if you need to, you can go to a disciplinary because they're not competent to do the tasks. So there's another kind of takeaway for that. So we've spoken enough. It's your chance really to ask questions if you'd like to.
I'm sorry, you didn't see a sort of CC type person. Quite interesting talking about that sort of hierarchy of who can decide who's competent and all the rest of it, which is perhaps fantastic. I picked up the bit about, and also I think it was a slide about fully engaged with HR lot. In reality, are the HR lot really going to know what the engineers are about? They ain't really, are they? So coming on to, I've actually bought a copy, which is fantastic, I've got a paint a building yet, but it talks about external validation, or that it, what it implies. The trouble there is, in my experience, when I go out and audit organisations for 50,001, which you haven't mentioned here, which is a trick, because in one of the clauses, it actually talks about competency training and awareness. I repeatedly find people are saying, yes, I'm fine, yes, they're fantastic. And I go, who says so?
Yeah.
And who is it that's saying that these people are okay? And what's their background? And so on and so forth. Now, I know in the world of litigation, you just get top colour emails or whatever it is, and that's in practical terms how it works. Could I have your feedback on the how do you know whether these people are competent and how you're going to get the HR gurus involved in all of this, really, practically?
I'm going to take it if that's all right. I didn't get your name. Tony, pleased to meet you.
Absolutely. Right,
Tony. There are company and there are accreditations out there that go along and do the sort of thing that you're asking for. People use Gas Safe Register as one of the examples.
Yep.
Can I borrow your magazine?
You can.
Because
you've just
highlighted the topic that we've been talking about. In
Modern Building Services.
Modern Building Services. Two of the first people to be registered by the ECS. As registered electrician, where they have been individually audited and checked and given their levels. So some organisations are starting to do it and give that. And that's, as I say, that just came out as we've come through now. But to get on to your topic, Tony, and to context the book as it's gone through, the organisation, when it goes through its process and it goes through its management system, should give the competency accreditation in writing where there is significant risk within their business tasks that they have identified that needs to be managed by a competent person, and give him a letter of instruction or a job description with full limitations, and they should sign to say that you're competent to do that role. And that's going through a learning cycle, through a few tests. Because in the end, who gets taken to court? The line manager, his senior manager, the area director, the company CEO, and then the chairman stands in. Getting an external body in to give you self-accreditation doesn't give you the confidence that you need. You need to have it internally embedded within your organisation. And that's the approach that we've tried to put within the document, which is why we had trouble badging competency. It isn't a badge, it's an award that you're given in recognition by the company to carry out tasks that they see as being significantly risk and having the proportion and need that level of competence within the organisation. So that helps us, our approach.
Thank you.
Okay. Yep.
Don McCulloch of PPL Training. I spent 40 years in the FM environment with one guy or another. What do you think the challenge is? We've been talking about the FM industry in this, but my experience is the bigger risk to the organisation is a contracting body. How do you see this competency filtering into that organisation? Because that sometimes becomes a risk in itself.
You mean subcontracted body?
Yes.
So my view on this is that, strictly speaking, as you're probably aware, that every time you subcontract an activity, the person that's brought that organisation or individual in has a responsibility to ensure that that person is capable and competent to fulfil the role that they're doing. I know it doesn't always happen. People assume, through what Steve's mentioned, that they've signed up to a corporate badge called Construction Line or something like that, that every member of their team is to a prescribed level. We know that's not the case. So I think what we're trying to do here is to start with this guidance, promulgate that through the FM people on the ground at the operational level, to give them the tools that allow them to make that challenge to those subcontractors. Yes, there's things like PAS 99 and those types of things which are pre-qualification documents in their own right, but they only look at the organisation, they don't look at the individuals that are employed. So it's a good point, but we've got to start somewhere. And I think it starts with us, with those people that are in charge of placing orders and subcontract arrangements on subcontractors. Soon as we start putting in a little bit more of a hard line and saying, Fred turned up to do the fire extinguisher testing, we've checked his competence, sorry, sent him away, then they're going to get the message. Business will start to be lost. There will be a reinvestment in training in those subcontracted organisations, and we will see a sea change. I believe that, but until we actually play that hard line and we keep letting them get away with it and unknowingly putting ourselves at risk, things won't change.
I think having read the new publication, it's good to see you have got a competency assessment for subcontractors in there.
Again, it's an example, it's a template, as Steve said. It's something to start with. The intent is that you use that, develop it, badge it, but at least you've got something. And to come back to Joe's point, you've now got a record and you can demonstrate that you've gone through a process. You are some way protected if something happens. No problem.
Question?
Yeah. Sorry, Mark Griffiths from I'm interested to. I've had the pleasure or the pain of working with both JSP 375, which is the NIB standard, and HTMs. And I've seen them work well, I've seen them work poorly as well, but that tends to be locally, you say, by the behaviours. But if followed, what is this giving that's different to those? As an example, I mean, there's other ISO standards out there, you could say 18001 covers a lot of this with the health and safety requirements. But
so what we're seeing with the GSPs and the HTMs is people are using within the industry those job titles to define people's competence, but not giving them the scope and definition that's embedded within the main document that you're talking about. Yeah. They're just saying you're an AP. I want you to take on the role as senior AP. And they're writing into the job description, AP, authorising person. But they're not giving the definitions of what that authorising person is and tasks and levels that all, and they're not even audit checking that they can meet them. They're just saying that you'll do that score. That's what we're seeing within the document.
No, I agree entirely.
We're seeing there are job titles or there are scopes of work that are getting put into bigger job titles.
I haven't had the pleasure of reading the document yet, but in terms of is that next level of detail, is it kind of really drilling into what you can do to make it
yes.
Follow it? Because if you follow those, you get what you're asking for.
Yes.
We're not rewriting those.
No.
What we're saying is people are misusing. What we're saying is people are misusing it.
Yes. I agree entirely. Yeah. I think that audit function is one of the key ones.
And you put it in a job description, but it needs to be part of their whole definitions to what they do. And I'm a firm believer, you've got to define the limitations.
Yeah. I think you're right, because I think, from my point of view, we train about 140 authorised engineers, the type we've been talking about, a year. And the big issue isn't within the MOD and the HTM organisation, it's where somebody comes to us and says, oh, just implemented the GSP 375 for our organisation and we're a manufacturer. And the problem with that is that
Work in there.
I think your framework you've got there will give you that framework to build on.
So it comes back to appropriate and proportionate. Yeah. So no one size fits all.
Yeah. And we think following a sort of model like this, you'll be scalable. So if you're a one-man subcontracting organisation, you can run it through your subcontracting organisation.
We're also saying it doesn't just work for your trades and your skill team stuff. It can actually work through your management system. If you look at it all the way through and up to your COO or your chairman. They can use this structure and formal system to make sure his board's at the right level. Lots of companies go through re-engineering, or they get a new client, they'll move out of commercial industry FM and they'll go into petrochem, or they'll go into hospital work, and it's totally different. It's a totally different environment. I need to reskill my team. I can't just send my normal man in a van engineer to these places. It's a totally different environment. You need to look at it, regularly review it and check it.
Any more questions?
Having both project and worked in the FM side many years ago, and many years, what you're talking about here appears to me, you're talking about effectively the skilled craft level, you know, the person who's HGM electrician, whatever. And I'm none of those. I'm an engineer, I'm a general engineer. Don't put a blow lamp in my hand, I'll burn your building down, you know. I'm that kind of person who hasn't got those skills, but knows what should be done, and have organised the thing overall. And what I'm seeing here is, seems to me that you can always check that somebody got the right certificate. Person 17 of the, you know, the IE regs, etc. Those kind of things, and you can always see whether somebody's got that or not. And that is fairly defined. But the further up you're going, you're asking people to go out of those areas which are quite defined, plus explicit, you know, quite quantifiable in the sense of those regulations or whatever they are, and taking on other skills which are more common sense, you know, sort of low-level managerial sort of things. And are they capable of doing that? Is that guy realizing that guy over there is doing something unrelated, but it's going to have an impact upon him, you know? And then you get that, and the further up you go, at each of those levels, somebody's having to make a judgment about the competence of the person below.
Yep.
And only at the very lowest level, I don't mean lowest in anything other than the hierarchy, is it very explicit? You know, is he a qualified electrician or not? You know, is he a qualified, do pressure vessels or whatever it is? The further up you go, whoever's making those judgments, there's going to be a lot of judgment involved in this, human related judgment, things that are not tangible, that don't lend themselves to this, you know? And the further up you go, it becomes more managerial and possibly a little bit commercial. And you can, and I don't know whether, I haven't read the document yet, but I wonder whether, you talk about these you yourself say all these terminologies, but you said they're useless, you know? But.
Not my phrase, but.
I know what you meant, because what you meant was, is they can't really be defined.
Yes, correct.
And whatever definition you put upon them of themselves can be challenged.
Yes.
You know? And you've got that all the way through. I mean, I personally have seen situations, quite serious, yet they stem from somebody who's supposedly, you know, is a gas safe person, and the lack of proper judgment in exercising that all the way through caused some very, very serious issues, you know, because things weren't picked up, weren't done properly, you know. So you there seemed to be a lot of this, you know.
So
and something like
that. Peter, wasn't it?
Peter.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just to go on, and Steve was going to hopefully take over as I go through it. Qualifications and knowledge is only part of what we're seeing in here as a definition of competency. The intangibles are practical thinking skills, the willingness to undertake a task, ability to apply them, and they're all things that you need to, as a manager, to assess that the person is at that right level. They're the intangibles, personal intangibles, that you need to review when you go through and you do your performance reviews on an annual basis or a 6-monthly basis, depending on how your company runs it. That's where. Just because a person has a qualification does not mean he's competent.
Yes.
Absolutely.
And that's,
you know, but people have to have, when the moment that somebody goes away from doing the simplest task, you have to give them the ability to exercise judgment.
So if I'm doing a gas safety inspection, legally I have to have my gas safety certificate and be credited for it.
It doesn't mean
that I'm competent to do what's on the card.
Yeah, I get your point about going up further up being less defined, but I think ultimately it's about what does the organisation want? What does the organisation feel is appropriate for that particular individual in that particular role? It is for the organisation to define. And as long as they've then had that discussion, that competency review, and assessed against those criteria, whatever they might be, at least they've done something. They're able to demonstrate something, and that's a whole lot better than nothing.
Okay, so we've taken our allocated. Oh, one quick one. Go on then.
I know, sorry. I don't work in facilities management, I work for a company that owns buildings.
Yeah.
So, coming from this different side. But in general, I mean, obviously, want my facility manager to be amazingly competent. And it's great if I can put that on you guys and say, tell me everyone's competent, happy, now I'm going to go away and leave that to you. But in general, are people asking you these questions, like people who own the building or going, are you making sure your guys are confident, or are they just assuming that you've got something to care of it? And if they're not, what should we be asking you? And also, it would be great if you had to do all of this, make sure everyone's competent, have your amazing CMS, everything sorted. Do you have the resources and the time to do it? Because I feel
if
like
we, don't,
we get the message that we're already squeezing you guys so much.
What if we don't do it?
Yeah.
What if we don't put competent people in the right
place? Oh, that would be terrible for us.
Yeah. So I think we as an industry need to make the time for that, and there's really no excuses for that.
What we're seeing within the document is we're utilising current processes, we're just modifying them and make them work.
Yeah.
Mm. So there is a HR process, and generally people have got a management system for competency, but they might not be following the same path.
Yeah.
So the management competency system, as I explained when we went through, starts off when you put your review of the job that you're asking to be undertaken and defining it before you put it out to press. Then you recruit somebody to assess against the skills that they've got. Then as you go through the induction, you make sure that they're of the right ability and they suit the role, they suit the company and the people they're working with. And then it goes through the business and they continue their employment. Then you will start to develop, train and re-educate. There's always a gap. Very rarely will you employ somebody who exceeds the task that you're bringing them in, because you probably wouldn't retain it. So you always generally employ somebody because they're keen and they're enthusiastic. They're coming on board for a challenge.
Yeah.
But we need to be smarter on how we look after it. And as Joe says, you need to look at the consequence. And it's all down to managing the risks in the organisation, not necessarily the competence of the person who you're employing.
Ask your supplier to show you the records. It, you know, it's not unreasonable for you to expect that you're employing a competent organisation with competent people. You would be, you know, shall we say, morally flawed if you didn't, because you wouldn't employ an incompetent organisation.
You'll have to ask the open floor, you can open that to the floor, to be honest.
I think it comes back to the point made at the very beginning about audit. It's when an organisation, so a building owner, when you've employed an organisation, you occasionally would want to audit an organisation and say, am I getting what I paid for? Is the service quality that I'm receiving appropriate? And is it being delivered by the correct resources? So that audit, in terms of, well, is that person competent? Please show me his training records. Please show me his audit process, and demonstrate that to me. That's not unreasonable.
But go for the larger high-risk tasks.
Yeah, absolutely.
Go for the larger high-risk tasks. Don't go for prove my security guard is competent, prove my fire alarm.
Yeah.
Go for the higher risk.
Health and safety risk.
There's things that are likely to impact on your business if something goes wrong. I don't know what you do as an organisation, but look and think about what you do and what your major risks are, then go with your supplier and say, how are you managing the risks with regards to allocating me the right level of competent people to manage?
Make it part of your monthly assessment.
No, you've got one more sure. Quick one. Yeah.
Okay.
Is there one more? That's good.
No, I was just thinking of it on this same general vein, is that you can't actually, and it's something you alluded to some degree yourselves here, is you can't actually, the further up you go, you can't separate competence from the management structure within which that operates. You know, I see a situation, people who are highly technically competent, but because of the management structure within they're operating, it still causes a failures, big failures.
Yes.
Yeah.
And it's because, oh, well, because, you know, I thought that, or it was okay, you know.
We try.
You can't separate the two.
We try to go out with the document and say that this isn't a tradesman's skills, this can...
It's a framework.
It's a framework that can go through an organisation. CEO downwards.
There was one more thing about why we came tonight. We had to turn up, so this fellow didn't nag us for every day.
It was the sandwiches. I was definitely told it was the sandwiches.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so I'll just close off a couple of minutes. Thanks, everybody. So that's official. It's launched tonight. Yourselves and us will be pushing it in all directions. There's a press launch. We'll be pushing it at other events and mentioning it. I think it's a fantastic document. I think it really pulls together all of the things that's needed. Some of it exists, but it's a consolidated view. And for me, it's about leadership. You know, talked about some fuzzy things tonight. This is leadership. Push this together and clarify some of those areas, which I think is what it needs. So watch out for the future, because I think it'll be great with it. As we mentioned before, if you want to buy one tonight, at half the price you can. And another cost is trust. So the arrangement is you can either pay by cash, and Sibsy will send you a receipt. If you've got a business card, they'll even trust you to take one away, providing you pay in the future. If not, we'll hunt you down. So just a few apart from forms, for those that, if they wanted to be a forum, can record it with a CPD certificate you can take away. There's some membership forms for the FM group, which is free if you're not already a member, just fill the form in. And then also Steve Clare, if you're interested in becoming an affiliate or a member of Sibsy, if you're not already. Few events from our group. 21st of February, if you're up near Leeds University, I'm speaking with the Yorkshire Group region on leadership, the opportunity. Then March, we've got another FM event to be confirmed. 12th, 13th of April, the FM group will hopefully present something at the Technical Symposium, which is in London. In May, we've got our annual joint FM group, ASHRAE group meeting, which always attracts a lot of people, is a landmark building as always. We're hopefully presenting and have a stand at the facility show in June, a September event, and in November, through discussions, we hope to be again presenting or chairing a session at the Building to Perform Sibsy event in London. So all I'd like just to say now, thank you all for attending, particularly Steve Cheshire and his team in Brookfield for hosting us, and the refreshments you will be able to receive. Thank you again, but above all, not just for their presentations, their quality, but the years of effort Joe, Steve and Steve have put in to produce this document to get us where we are today. So thank you very much.